You know, we are in the last Sunday of this year, and we are at the very edge, if I can call it an edge. We are at the last almost the last 10 days of 2015. We are going to be celebrating Christmas. We're going to be celebrating what God did in 2015. We're going to thank God for what He did in 2015. And we're going to enter into 2016 with great rejoicing. We're going to enter into 2016 with great amount of thanksgiving. So I want us to really take this morning and reflect. Okay, reflect on the things that we have to change. You know, the book that I'm preaching from this morning is Zephaniah. Everybody says Zephaniah. So this book is one of the prophecy books in the New Old Testament. We're almost reaching the end of the Old Testament, right? So this is the prophet Zephaniah. And if you see one theme, if I have to ask you, what is the one theme throughout all the prophecy books, throughout all the prophecy books in the Old Testament, what is the one major theme? What is the one thing that they all prophesied? Sorry? Thus says the Lord, coming of? Coming of Jesus, yes. Sorry, God loves you. Okay, anything else? He still loves you. Anything else? Anything else? For me, I think the one message that comes back and forth throughout the entire prophecy books in the Old Testament is a message of repentance. God is continually speaking to His people, guys, you have to repent now. If you don't repent, these are the judgment that will befall you. These are the things that will come your way. But if there is still time. If you want to repent, there is still time. Change your ways. Change the way that you live. Change the way that you talk. Change the way that you do your business. Change your life. That's the one message that comes over and over and over again through the Old Testament. Amen. Through the books of the prophecy, right? Now, even in the book of Zephaniah, that is what we're going to be speaking about. I have titled this morning's sermon as a call to repentance. Zephaniah chapter 2, verse 1 to 3. Can we all read the verses together? The book of Zephaniah. Chapter 2 and verses 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, here we go. Gather together. Yes, gather together, you shameless nation. Verse 2. Gather before judgment begins, before your time to repent is blown away like chaff. Act now before the fierce fury of the Lord falls and the terrible day of the Lord's anger begins. Seek the Lord, all you who are humble, and follow His commandments. Seek to do what is right and to live humbly. And everybody said an amen. Amen. And everybody said an amen. Amen. Okay, that's the amen I was expecting, because this is not a word that I am going to tell you and say, hey, you know what, God is going to bless you, God is going to exalt you, God is going to take you to heights. This is a sermon which will cause us to introspect ourselves and check, hey, where are we going wrong? What are we doing that is not glorifying God? What are we doing that is not bringing praise to Jesus? What are we doing that is not bringing honor to the kingdom of God? Amen? There are five things that I'm going to drive across through this three verses. And I really want us to take that home. Amen? The first thing that God says is, guys, gather together. Amen? Come together. You are dispersed all over the place. Each man is doing his own thing. Each woman is doing her own work. Instead, gather together. Come together. Let's not be isolated. You know, when the enemy wants to attack you, the first thing that he does is he will isolate you. Do you know that? What he does is he will individually take you to the corner and then he will pounce on you. The enemy is not capable of fighting a community. He is not capable of fighting an organization together, but he knows this is the one way to bring down people. It is to disconnect them from the community. It is to isolate them into individuals and then pounce on them one by one. How many of you watch Natural Geography? Have you seen how these animals who want to prey on people on the animals, what they will do is they will isolate them. They will wait till the time they go to the water or till the time they wander off into the... They will wait in hiding. When they are together in a group, no animal will jump and, you know, take out one deer and run away. Nobody. I was watching this video and there was this huge, humongous tiger, okay, who jumped on a big bullock and was eating, had already started gnawing on it and trying to kill. And then suddenly there was two bullocks that saw this, like from a really far off distance, okay? And these two, probably they were friends, they used to go to church together or whatever, and they came running, and I mean, this is there on YouTube. If I find the link, I'll share this with you. And these guys, the way they mauled that tiger down, like, you know, they came and they, with their horns, they threw the tiger up in the air, and the tiger went about 14 feet high. You can imagine how much power there is when they came together, right? That's what the enemy doesn't want you to experience. That is why the enemy disconnects you from people, disconnects you from fellowship, disconnects you from your family, disconnects you from the community that God has placed you in. Amen. One of the main times when people go astray, when young people, they go astray, is when they are off in their hostels or in their when they are away from their homes. Why? Because that is the time they are on their own. They are not in a community. They are not in their family. They are not in that protective environment. Amen? Amen. That is why it's so necessary for us to remain, to gather together, to not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of His return is drawing near. Amen. Do not neglect it. Do not ignore it. Do not take it light. Amen. Instead of ignoring, this is what you do. You encourage one another. This is what the verse says. It says, encourage one another. Do not neglect. Instead, encourage one another to do what? To gather together, to meet together, to go to fellowship, to go to church. No matter where you are, if you are even in Serbia or in Russia or in China, you know, you have to go looking for a church and go to a place of fellowship on every Sunday morning. Amen? Why is it necessary for you to do that? Because the Bible says, do not ignore it. Do not neglect it. Amen? I like people who are passionate about the presence of God, who are passionate about the house of God. The Bible says, David said this, I was glad when they said to me, come, let's go to the house of the Lord. When are we glad when somebody says, come, let's go for a movie? Or when are we happy when somebody says, oh, come, let's go watch a cricket match? When do we rejoice? Gather together. Gather together. Be in the house of God. Be in the presence of God. You know, find your own small group of people. It's not just about being in church, but find your own small group of three or four friends and gather together regularly in prayer. Gather together wherever you are. Gather together with people and let there be an accountability. Amen? Amen? And when you gather together, be respectful of the place that you have gathered at. Be respectful. Honor the place that you have come into. Amen? One of the things that I constantly say in church is that, hey, when you come to church, switch off your phones. Morning. You don't do anything related to your work, or, you know, I can imagine a family emergency. But other than that, you don't bring your work into the church service. Amen. All the 6 days of the week, work hard, give your best, do your best. But when you come to church on Sunday, you take your phone and and just don't even bring it to the church. Leave it in your bikes downstairs, you know, just lock it up there and just come. So you're not even tempted to go and check who is WhatsApping me. You're not even tempted to check the latest Instagram picture. You know, you just give your 100%. Amen. And along with that, I want to bring up this point as well. Can we all be intentional about being on time in church? Yeah. I want every one of us to be intentional about reaching on time. Like, I was just asking my wife yesterday, you know, that, you know, Zahal had an annual day in her school yesterday. We would not say that, hey, you know, it is definitely going to begin at least 10, 15 minutes late. Let's go late. We're not going to do that for a school function. We're not going to do that for an office function. But when it comes to God, we take it so light. They're like, oh man, church can wait. It doesn't matter if I miss 15, 20 minutes of worship, right? It really doesn't matter. It matters. You know, like Pastor Subi said it last Sunday, God is not surprised by your word or by your sermons, because the sermons, he only gave it to you, right? But God, what the part that God enjoys is your worship, because that is something that God comes to receive from you. Amen? That is something that you give to God. That is something, you know, this is us receiving for ourselves so that we can grow in our walk with God. But the worship is that time when we want to give to God. That is why we have to be intentional about coming in time and giving our best to God. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So the first thing is that we have to gather together. Everybody say, gather together. If ever the enemy tries to isolate you, immediately gather together. Just connect with somebody. If at any point of time the enemy speaks into your head and says, hey, nobody cares for you, nobody loves you, nobody wants you, immediately call your friend and say, hey, you know what? I'm having some negative thoughts. Will you please pray for me? Can we just spend some time in prayer together? I'm feeling alone. Let me, you know, can we just make a group? And that's something that I have been encouraging constantly. Find a prayer buddy, you know, make a prayer buddy in church who can pray with you on an everyday basis. Amen. Subscribe to the podcast that we do every day, you know, and listen to it in the morning if you're able to. Those are not supposed to be your Bible. Those are not supposed to replace your Bible reading, definitely. Those are supposed to be stuff that will encourage you to read your Bible. Amen? Don't say that, oh, I've listened to the podcast, I've had my prayer, so I'm not going to read my Bible today. No, those are supposed to encourage you to do that. But it's necessary that you constantly gather together and you receive from God. Amen?
Amen.
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 Amen. That's great. So the first thing that God wants us to do is to constantly gather together, right? The second thing that God wants us to do, God wants us to know, God wants to remind us that this is your time to repent. Everybody say, time to repent. In verse 2, it says, gather before judgment begins, before your time to repent is blown away. It says, this is the time to repent. And there is a time when the time to repent will get over. You know, there was a time when the Holy Spirit will not necessarily keep fighting with your spirit and say, hey, you know what, you need to change. There is a time when we'll reach there. But this is the time, this is the season of repent. Repent, is it the time when we all cry before the communion service and say, oh God, I did that, I did this, I'm so sorry, I'll not do this ever again in my life. I mean, we do that, right? Like, anybody else other than me who have done that? I used to feel like the worst sinner on earth every time, only before the communion service, because, you know, there's somebody who actually died in my church when they had the communion, right? I mean, taking the communion is a serious thing. The Bible says that some fall sick and some even die when they do it in a dishonorable way. So I come from a church like that. So you can imagine how scared I'll be, right? Because I know that 100 out of 100 times I have lied. I have done so many things which, and I'll be like, oh man, God, you know, and I'm like, okay, God, I have done my repenting part. I do that every week. That's not the repentance that this is talking about. The repentance, you know, the New Testament understanding of repentance is completely different. The New Testament, the word that is used is a Greek word, metanoia. Okay, I'm not pronouncing that right. I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing it wrong. It means change of mind. Repentance is not about just crying, and it's you changing your mind. The Bible says in Romans 12:2 that you have to renew your mind. Change your pattern of thoughts. Change. That is what repentance is truly about. Repentance is not an emotional thing. Repentance is a very, very intellectual thing where you change the way that you think. Where you change the way that you look at people. Where you change the way that you, in your mind, you process conversations in your mind. You change it in your mind. Amen? That is what repentance is all about. That is what repentance is all about. Let's read Acts chapter 3, verse 19 and 20. Now that you know what repentance is, I want you to read these scriptures based on those, based on the understanding that we have just received, right? What does it say? Change your mind, right? Okay, now let's read Acts chapter 3, verse 19 and 20. Okay, this is what it says. Now, repent of your sins and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped away. Verse 20. It says, then times of refreshment will come from the presence of the Lord, and He will again send you Jesus, the appointed Messiah. Amen? Amen. Now, this is what this is what Peter is preaching. He's saying, repent of your sins. Now, let's replace repent with change your mind. Is that okay? Now, change your mind about your sins and turn to God. Change your mind. Change the way that you look at your sins. Change the way that you look at your wrongdoing. Change the way that you process sin in your head. You know, when you change your perspective about sin, that sin will no longer be able to control you. For example, you know, some of you know my history of how I was like deep into addiction to pornography I had seen so much of pornography that it was just, you know, you just don't want to look at another woman and get into a conversation because you feel that, man, I might be looking with the wrong perspective. I might lust. It was a big thing in my heart that I can never have a normal conversation with another woman. And that is when God changed my mind. God spoke to me through this one word in I think it's in 1st or 2nd Timothy where Paul tells Timothy, he says, consider older women as mothers and younger women as sisters. So I'm like, hey, this is a good idea. Let me try this. You know, and I changed the way that I looked at my sin. What was my sin? Lust was my sin, right? Now, I did not sit and cry and repent in the traditional fashion as much as I changed the way that I look at my sin. What did I do with my sin? I renewed my mind according to what the Bible says. Amen. What does the Bible say? Bible says, treat older women as mothers and younger women as sisters. When I started doing that in my head, automatically, it made sense to me. Automatically, the problem of lust went away. Amen? Now, do this to every area of sin that you would struggle with. Change the way that you look at it. Instead of, you know, no matter how many times you sit and you cry and you say sorry, it's not going to help you till you change your mind. Does it make sense? Have you had times where you're like, oh man, I did it again. Oh man, I lied again. You know, I had a problem with lying. And you know what God spoke to me? God said, your words have power. And that is why you're supposed to speak the truth. And then I started being so careful about every word I speak. And when God started to speak to me about the favor of God on my tongue, I was like, man, I need to be very careful with the words that I speak. It was again a change of mind. No amount of crying before the communion will take me out of the habit of sinning. Amen? What will change my habit of sinning is a change of mind. Everybody say change of mind. Renewing your mind. Yeah? And when you renew your mind, it's not so much emotional. Let me tell you that. You know, you are expecting for a very emotional, oh man, I feel it, this is it, this is the last time I did it. No, that's not what it is. It is in your mind. When you change your mind, when you change the way that you look at your sin. Amen. What does the Bible say in verse 20, Acts 3:20? It says, when you do this, times of refreshment will come from the presence of God. God is just waiting to send you times of refreshment. Everybody say refreshment. You know, when we say refreshment in church, what does it mean? It means something good, right? It doesn't mean something harmful. It means good. It means that, hey, you've been tired of listening to Pastor Priji for the last 3 hours. Here is a refreshment so you don't go back tired. You know, you go back happy and joyful and glad in your heart. Amen? Amen? That is what God is going to send your way. It says when when you've been carrying a sin for ages, for decades, and finally you decide to change your mind about it, what God, what you cannot do is, remove the burden that it is there on your shoulders. That is what God will do for you. He will send a season of refreshment, a time of refreshment from the presence of God into your life. And everybody said an amen. And everybody said an amen.
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 Amen. So that's the second thing. What's the first thing? What is the first thing? What is the second thing? This is the? We are in the time to repent. Amen. Now the third thing. This is where it gets a little more interesting. It says in verse 2, act now before the fierce fury of the Lord falls. The third thing that God wants us to do in this season is that we begin acting upon our convictions. Act now. Act now. You know, Bible says in James chapter 2 verse 14. I want everybody to remember this verse, okay? Can we have the scripture? James chapter 2 and verse 14. What good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say that you have faith but don't have actions to show, but don't show it by your actions, can that kind of faith help or save anyone? It says, what kind of faith is it that doesn't come out in actions, that doesn't start manifesting in actions, right? So here we are, we have gathered together, we are changing our perspective on coming to church, we are changing our perspective on being in the presence of God, on honoring the presence of God, on being punctual, being consistent, all of that. And then God is saying, hey, it's not enough that you gather, it's also necessary that you change your mind, because this is the time to repent. So you change your mind about things and you change the way that you look at things and then you start walking in this line. And the next thing that God says, that God expects you to do, is begin acting. Everybody say act now.
Act now.
Act now.
Act now.
So which means that I cannot just be casual and say, oh man, I have changed my mind and, I am going to never do this. But hey, but what are you going to do? What are you going to do? You cannot just sit idle in the presence of God. You have to be a man or woman of action. Does it make sense? You have to be somebody who is constantly in pursuit of what God has placed upon your life. See, this is the reason why many a times people fall off or they backslide, or they go into a completely different way of life, is because they never had a purpose ahead of them. Why you come into church? Why are you a child of God? Why are you alive on earth? Because there is communion in church every Sunday, you know? Or because I get refreshments, you know? Because, I feel good, right? Hey, what is the purpose behind your life? Do you have a purpose for what you're doing? When you have a purpose, you will have the necessary actions that has to go along with that purpose. Does it make sense? When you don't have a purpose, you will not have any actions. You will not have a plan of action. But you have, when you have a purpose, when you have, you know, a couple of Sundays back, we did our goals and plans for 2016, right? How many of you remember that? How many of you remember? We planned what are we going to do in the whole of 2016 together in church, right? So, because we have those plans, because we have those goals, what are we going to do? We will have actions. What are the actions? You know, January 1st and 2nd, we're going for a leadership retreat. You know, the very next week onwards, we're going to be training leaders and help and equipping them in trying to pick up those responsibilities and start walking in them. There is actions because there is a purpose, because there is a plan. Many a times we don't have actions because we don't know what we are about to do. And all we're thinking is that, oh man, I just want to make some money. I just want to feed my children. I just want to, hey, you know what? The dogs on the road also do that. I can take a video of it and show it to you. How the dogs on the street outside my house, they take care of their children. They live a full, satisfied life, barking at everybody in the neighborhood. And they have a fun life. What is the difference between that dog and us? What is our difference? This is the difference. The difference is that we are people who live with a purpose in our lives. Amen. We are people who have a purpose behind everything that we do. And because we have a purpose, we have a plan of action. Everybody say plan of action. So you know, and it's not that, okay, when I get a salary of 30,000 rupees, I will start doing this. No. Hey, start today. What does the Bible say? Act now. When the new year begins, right? Like 1st of January onwards, you know, you can start doing your actions, you know. Don't start your Bible reading plan now. Don't do it. You know, you'll be out of sync, you know. Start for Jan 1st. You have exactly 365 days and, you know, delay to Jan 1st, right? That's what the Bible says, right?
No.
What does it say? Act
now.
Act now. If you cannot practice what you're supposed to do in January, for the next 10 days, you will not do it in January. I can write it down on paper for you. If you're not going to have the guts and the capacity to read your Bible when you're busy, you will not read your Bible when you're free. Do you understand what I'm saying? If you don't spend time in prayer when you're busy, do you think your heart is going to be passionate enough to spend time praying? Heart will crave for, that mall, that, you know, the basement, there is that Zara shop, you know. You just want to go and you leave your wallet behind just to see, you know, just in case there is a sale, there is a discount, you know, you just want to pick up something. No, that's what your heart will crave for if that's what you've been doing always. Amen. I want us to be a church who is not just big in talking, but big in actions. Amen? And, you know, this is what the Bible says of Zacchaeus. What did Zacchaeus do when he repented? Anybody who's read their Bibles? He gave back. Whatever he had taken back, he had gave back fully. Double. Divya gets it right. He gave four times of what he had stolen from people. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine? I mean, this guy has to be wealthy for him to give back four times of, you know, I'm sure he would have become bankrupt by the end of the evening. But his repentance was followed by actions. When you're willing to repent, but it's, you know, you're like, oh God, I have repented. Yes, I've changed my mind. But there's no actions. It is dead. What does the Bible say in James 2 verse 14? Your faith, your repentance, your belief system, when it is not followed by actions, it is dead. That is why it is necessary for you to act and act now. And everybody say, act now. Act now. Amen. So whenever God tells you, God leads you to do something, immediately take the next step and begin your action step. Amen. Start working on your life and say, hey God, yes, I'm going to do more and I will have a plan of action ready. Amen. I want you to go into 2016 with a clear heart. I want you to go into 2016 with a plan of action. You know, I'm not trying to ask you to make New Year resolution, but I'm asking you to make a plan of action. I'm asking you to chart out your goals and tell yourself, this is where I want to be at the end of 2016. And because this is my purpose, this is the goal, this is my plan of action. This is how many hours I need to spend in praying. This is how many hours I need to, spend in talking about it. This is how many things that I need to do. You know, for example, one of my goals for 2016 is to buy a new car. You know, everybody smile, please. Don't look at me with those eyes. Yeah, that's my goal. So what do I do? I'm like, okay, God, I am going to buy a car. I am going to buy a car. And I'll pray every day. Hey, wait a minute. Stop spending money on McDonald's. Start saving up that money. As simple as that. You know, stop going out more often. You know, keep that money apart. Keep that money aside. I saw this car and, you know, we were like so amazed that we're going for a test drive this week. We don't have any money, right? But we're going to go do a test drive this week and we're going to, by faith, declare that 2016 we'll be able to buy this car. Amen, yes. Dilip is saying amen because he's sick of the car that we are already in. He has to sit in that car and every time I fly over potholes, you know, he's like, oh man. And we're going to see that belief, that faith that I want to buy a new car, if it is not followed by actions, if I am not putting my actions. Now, bringing the provisions, it is God's job, right? But my job is to still labor. What does the Bible say? Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders, they labor in vain. Hence, the builders don't have to build, only let the Lord build. Is that what the Bible says? No. The builders, we still build. We still do our part. And then the Bible says, unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchmen stand guard in vain. And when we do our part of being awake and being alert and standing guard throughout the time, what will God do? God will breathe and God will also stand guard along with us. Amen. And when what we are doing might be like little, like this little, right? Like for example, Moses, do you think that there was so much magnetic power in his stick that it could part the waves and the... No, but he still had to do his part. Until the time he did not do his part, God did not split the water. But when he did his part by stretching out the stick, what God did is God split the water. Amen? We have to do our part. We have to take a step of faith. And when we take a step of faith, when we act now, what God does is God will move on our behalf. Amen? God will do what is not possible with us. God will do what is impossible with us. Everybody said, amen. First, gather together. Let's repeat this. Gather together. It's a time to repent. And we act now. Okay? Now the fourth thing. This is very, very serious. Okay? It says in verse 3. It says, seek the Lord. Seek the Lord. Seek the Lord before all who are humble and follow His commandments. Seek to do what is right. Amen. So the fourth thing that I want is to you should become intentional about seeking God. Because many a times, it becomes, so much about the community, about gathering together and about, oh man, I have changed the way that I have thought, I'm also having actions to accompany that change of thoughts, and my belief system is being followed by actions. And then we become so much revolving around ourselves that we forget the reason why we were actually created. It was not so that you can buy a car in 2016. It was so that you can serve and worship God. Where if you do everything else, Jesus said this, what profit does a man if he gains the whole world? Who is Jesus talking about? He's talking about this one man who has done a lot of actions, who had the right belief system, who did a lot of actions. He saved up so much wealth that he didn't need food for his entire lifetime. He has food and money required for his entire lifetime. And what is God looking at him and saying? What profit does it when a man, he has everything, when he has gained the whole world, but he loses his own? So what are we in danger of when we stop seeking God? We are in danger of becoming just a community instead of becoming a church. What are we in danger of when we don't seek God? We become just a mind-changing, motivational lecture type. You know, you can get that out in the world. There are many people who teach about changing your mind and that will change your lifestyle. There are many people in the world who speak about actions. But the one place where God begins to breathe in all of this is when you begin to seek God. Amen? Amen? When you seek after the Lord. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6 that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. You know, many times as Christians, we have this word seeker, right? Seeker. We call all non-Christians and people who don't have a personal relationship with Jesus as seekers. They've not yet found the truth. They are seekers. And what are we? We are the found people, so we don't have to seek anymore. We don't have to pursue God anymore. But I understood this perspective after marriage. Is the fact that, you know, it doesn't matter how many times I have told my wife I love you before marriage. It doesn't make sense to her today. If I don't tell her today, man, she'll be an emotional wreck because she, you know, I have to tell her every day. You know, till the time that I don't let her know, I'm like, she's like, do you know you did not hug me today? I'm like, do you know that I promised that I'm going to love you all the days of your life, you know, 2 years back when we got married. But it doesn't matter. You know, it's a everyday consistent relationship. And many times we treat God like that. We are like, God, 1987, August 15, I promised to you that today onwards, I will live for Jesus. Yes, that's it. And after that, we are like, okay, we go to church. We have there's no continual pursuit of God's heart for your life. You know, it doesn't matter how spiritual you are. It doesn't matter if you are an ordinary person or a pastor in this church. Everybody in this place has to be somebody who will constantly pursue God. Not because we don't know who He is. We have a revelation. But every time we pursue Him, we get a deeper revelation of who He is. Amen? Seated next to the throne of God. Now, they are in a place of vantage. They are in a vantage point. They can see God. Right? Where is God? Right in front of them. Right? Do you think that they will be like, oh, we have seen God. Yes, we have seen God. Don't you think they'll get bored after some time? What does the Bible say? Every day. Man, because their hearts are after Him. Even sitting on the throne, their hearts are after Him. That when, you know, what does the Bible say? Those who seek will find. When you're pursuing after the heart of God, when God reveals a new side of Himself, you know what these guys does? They get off their thrones. They take off their crowns. They lay down before Him and they worship Him. Amen? Why do they do that? Because even sitting next to Him, they're constantly in pursuit of Him. Amen? How much more should we seek Him, pursue Him, when we are living in a wicked world like this? How much more should we run to him, draw near to him, the Bible says. Draw near to him and he will draw near to you, right? How much more should we pursue him? You know, one of the goals of our church, you know, we did this vision casting Sunday, right? And what did we say? To pursue God in prayer. That is one of the main goals of our church, one of the main visions in our church, that our church is a church that focuses on prayer. Our church is a church that is focused on pursuing after the heart of God. Amen? Amen. And that is what God wants us to do. That not just that we be happy. And this is what the Bible says, Matthew 7, verse 7. Let's read it together. Matthew chapter 7 and verse 7. Keep on seeking and you will receive what you seek for. Keep on knocking and the door will be opened to you. Amen? Amen. It is not a one-time action. Pursuing God or seeking God is not something that it's a one-time incident. It's a consistent lifestyle process of continuing to seek God, continuing to pursue His heart, continuing to desire to know Him more, to know Him better. The Bible says, Paul, when he was praying for the Ephesians, this is what he prayed for them. My prayer is that you will know Him better, know Him more. Now, these guys already knew Him. If there is any church that was as matured in the New Testament, it was the church at Ephesus. But what did Paul pray? Paul said, that you may know Him better. Know Him more. Amen. That is my prayer for us, church. That we will pursue His heart. We will seek Him. And there will be a church that will know Him. Amen. The more we seek Him, the more we find Him. And the more we find Him, the more we love on Him. The more we love Him, the more we become like Him. Amen. So what's the first thing? We gather together. The second thing, that this is the time to repent. What's the third thing? That we have to act now. Amen. What's the fourth thing that God wants us to do together as a church? That we seek the Lord. That we pursue after God. Amen. And this is the last thing, without which everything will fall flat. This is what the Bible says. It says in verse 3. It says, seek to do what is right and to live humbly. Everybody say, live humbly.
Live humbly.
Live humbly.
Live humbly.
Now, you know, this is why I'm saying that this is the most important thing of all. The greatest sin in the whole Bible, the biggest sin was not that he lied about somebody. He didn't go to heaven and say, oh man, Michael, he tricked on me. He didn't lie. What did he do? He had pride. He said, I am higher than God. I am better than God. I have more glory. That is something that is the craziest, worst of a kind mistake that you can make. In fact, you should check out tomorrow's podcast where I'm talking about King Nebuchadnezzar, how he became so proud that, you know, when God showed him a vision, he said, no. This will not happen. God showed him a vision. What was the vision? There was a statue with a gold head and a bronze chest and a silver legs and then feet of dirt and clay, right? And what did Daniel say? Daniel said the gold head is you, right? And what did King Nebuchadnezzar say? No, that's not it. Then in the next chapter, Daniel chapter 3, he went and made a huge statue of gold. From top to bottom was gold. He's like, no man, I'm not going to end. I am going to be there from beginning to ending. It's all me. There is no kingdom that is going to come after me. What Daniel was telling him was, hey, you know what? You're the gold. You're the amazing, great, glorious kingdom. This is what God is saying about you. But there is going to be a kingdom that will come after you. But you know what Nebuchadnezzar said? No way. I am it. I am it. This is it. I am going to be the one king who will rule the world as long as time exists. And God had to break that, right? You know that story that the four guys, they fell into, they were put into furnace because they didn't worship this the three of them, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were all put into flames because they didn't worship this gold statue that Nebuchadnezzar had made. And that's the biggest mistake that you and I can do. That we can become so full of ourselves. Because you know what? When you seek God, perspective in your mind, when you're continually changing your mind, when you're continually working on your actions, you are going to get some real good progress in your life. Right? Yeah. You're going to increase. You're going to go big. Your life is going to take off. Your walk with God is going to take off. Your finances are going to take off. Your health is going to take off. Your businesses are going to take off. And that is the time when the enemy comes to you and say, oh, look at yourself. Where were you yesterday? See how you made all these things happen. If it was not for the way that you preached in church, you would have never had this, man. If it was not for the amazing skills of saving, you could have never bought this car. You know, if it was not for your amazing skills at marketing, you would have never got that job promotion. And that is the time when you have to come back and say, God, your word doesn't just command me to live that. Your word commands me to live humbly. But we be a church where we don't just pursue God in our spiritual life, but also in our character. You want to grow in your character, just be a humble person. Just pursue humility in your character. As long as you pursue humility in your character, the Bible says he who exalts himself will be brought down. But he who humbles himself will be exalted. Amen. When you humble yourself, God knows how to bring you acceptance. If people don't accept you, it's okay. You just remain humble, man. If God decides to exalt you, no man can stop it. Amen. When God decides to exalt you, no man can look at you and say, man, he is growing too much. Let me put a stop to him. No. You know, when people promote you, people can demote you. When God promotes you, people cannot even look at your promotion. Amen. That's one thing that I have been a firm believer in. Let us be a church that will live humbly. Let us be a church that will walk humbly. Let's be, you know, yeah, we have to do all the four things right. But at the end of the day, if we are not people of character, if the world cannot look at us and say, hey, that's a humble group there. You know, that church, they are not an arrogant group. They are not a stubborn people. They are a humble people. Amen. I want that to be the story about each and every one of us. That we be people who will be humble, who will be servants, who will be willing to go to the point of death. You know, when we do this, we are resembling ourselves, or we're becoming like Jesus. What does the Bible say in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5? The Bible says, let this mind be in you as it was in Christ Jesus. What was it in Christ Jesus? He was equal to God. He was in the very nature. He was God, but he humbled himself to the point of death. Even death on a cross. To the point of death, he humbled himself. I mean, none of us, you know, at the mats, what we have had to humble ourselves is to the point of somebody overtaking you in the car, right? You know, I mean, you've not had to humble yourself to the point that you've been crucified on the cross, right? But that's the point till which Jesus humbled himself. And that is the point to which God is calling us and saying, you know what, 2016, let it be a time when you and I, we live humbly. Amen. That we be people who don't ignore the church services, that we don't ignore fellowship, we don't isolate ourselves and live by ourselves, but we live in fellowship with one another. That we be people who have not just, you know, doing fellowship, but we change the way that we think. If there is a pattern of sin in my life, if there is a pattern of wrong thinking in my life, I have to get it fixed this season. During this time, I have to change the way that I look at things. Amen. That's not enough. It's necessary also that I begin acting on what I have been believing, that there will be actions that will follow my pattern of thoughts. It's not enough that I have actions, but it's necessary that I have a lifestyle of pursuing God. I have a lifestyle of running after God, of seeking continually. It's not, that's also not enough. It's necessary that I constantly humble myself in the presence of God. I say, God, I want to live humbly before your presence. Amen. I want to live humbly. You know, my humility cannot be verified by anybody else in this place. There's only one person who can really say that I am humble, and it's God. Even I cannot say I am humble. Why? Because the moment I say I am humble, I am proud about the fact that I am humble. Right? But only God can testify this about you. And God said this about Moses. When God says he is the most humble person out of all the people on earth. May that be the testimony that God
speaks. That brings
speaks
us to the end of this sermon.
Amen.
I hope you are blessed. Do join us for the Christmas service on 24th and the New Year service on the 31st night. And I hope that it will be a blessing to you. God bless you. See you there.